When the viewer pane is open, it normally loads each file as you select things. You can now make a button or hotkey to turn this off, locking the viewer to its current file. After clicking the button, the viewer continues to show the same image and doesn't react to selection changes. Clicking the button a second time reverts things to normal, and the currently selected file is loaded into the viewer. I usually edit this out, but let's show the whole thing this time. Right-click some empty space on your toolbar and choose Customize. Right-click again and choose New Button, then double-click the button which was created. Type in a label, which can be whatever you want. Select an icon, and you can use the filter here to narrow things down. Then give it a command, which you can often build using these menus. And click OK, and we're done. Let's assume a scenario where you want to tag every picture of a cat with a special status icon. This is an entirely hypothetical situation and not something I do in my spare time. Where images are tagged with status icons, the viewer's status bar now displays them. You can also add buttons to the viewer toolbar which toggle status icons for the current file. Now I can go through my images, tagging the ones that contain cats, without leaving the viewer. Here's the kind of command used by these buttons. It's a bit more complicated than most buttons which set labels, because it acts as a toggle, and it also adds labels without removing the existing ones. If you want to make your own status icons like this cat one, you can do so here in Preferences. Just as you can run commands directly from the file display against the currently selected files, you can now do the same thing from the viewer against the current image it's displaying. As with file displays, hotkeys in the viewer can be both standalone or derived from toolbars. The Customize window lists both types of hotkey and lets you search by pushing a hotkey into the search field at the bottom. The hotkey shows as Shift plus dot, since that's how the right angle bracket is typed on my keyboard. Here you can see the command which it runs. And if your configuration doesn't already have this, you can add a new viewer hotkey from this menu. The viewer lets you select parts of images to crop them or to copy bitmap data to the clipboard. The dimensions you select are usually unconstrained, but you can now create buttons which restrict selections to a specified ratio, such as 16 to 9. You can have another button which resets things to normal, or, with a bit more complexity, you can have a single button which toggles between the two states. The first line says the button should appear activated when in 16 to 9 mode and appear deactivated otherwise. The rest says, if we're already in 16 to 9 mode, then reset, otherwise go into 16 to 9 mode. Mouse actions in the viewer can now be configured in more detail. You can make the mouse wheel zoom in and out instead of moving between images. And the left button has several new options, including the ability to run arbitrary commands or even scripts. The new expand and scroll option is good for images that are larger than the viewer window. Clicking on an image will show it at full size, potentially using the full screen. While the button is held down, you can move the mouse around to scroll the image. When the button is released, everything returns to normal, and you can click an area to quickly see it at full size. An additional option makes clicking the left and right edges of the viewer move between images, similar to many web galleries. Most of the options we've seen for the left mouse button are also available for the middle mouse button, as well as double clicks on the left button. You can have a button or hotkey in the viewer, which locates the current image in a lister, opening a new one if required. It's also possible to make the lister which launched the viewer track the viewer's current file by simply installing an add-in. The slideshow speed can now be set to fractions of a second, which can be useful to animators working with one frame per file. To show you colour management, I have two copies of the same JPEG, one with the Adobe RGB 1998 profile embedded, and one without any colour profile at all. With colour management turned off, both images look identical, as they should. The colour management setting now has three options. If your monitor is calibrated to sRGB, you can simply select it here, as before. With that chosen, the image that doesn't have a colour profile remains as is, and the colours in the other image become slightly more saturated due to the conversion from its colour space to sRGB. What's new is the ability to load an external ICC profile which matches your monitor for monitors which are not calibrated to sRGB. To demonstrate this, I have a special test profile which completely swaps the red and green channels. And now the differences are very conspicuous. Let's look at some new image formats now. Opus has support for the Mixed Reality Viewer, which comes with Windows 10 and can display various 3D object file formats. HEIC images, as produced by some new phones, can now be displayed, provided the appropriate codecs have been installed. With Windows 10, you can get the codecs from the Microsoft Store, and there's also a third-party codec for Windows 7 users. In addition to the viewer and thumbnail support, the basic image metadata columns are now populated for this kind of file. We also now support Google's WebP image format, as well as Photoshop CMYK PSD files with alpha channels. And to demonstrate the alpha channel support, I'll set my viewer pane background colour to something much more conspicuous. As you can see, the PSD and WebP images are rendered on top of the colour that I chose. When images contain GPS coordinates, Opus can take you from them to various mapping services. This now includes OpenStreetMap, in addition to Google Maps and Microsoft Bing. Location services are now defined in Preferences, and you can add additional services by specifying their URL and where to insert the GPS coordinates. Each service is given a name, which you can then use in the Image Locate command. Microsoft Office documents should now display properly again in the viewer after we added a workaround for bugs in recent Office updates. Switching between Office documents of the same type should also be faster now. Unicode UTF-8 text files which do not start with a byte watermark or BOM can now be displayed correctly in the viewer by turning on a setting in the text plugin. And a similar option exists in the Find Files panel when searching for file contents. The undo log now has timestamps for each event, and the file log now lets you save its contents in both text and CSV formats. The duplicate file finder can now search for duplicates based on size alone. And in the Find Files panel's simple mode, you can now use regular expressions by using the regex prefix. A new option has been added to copy sparse files while maintaining their sparse properties. It's not usually important, but if it matters to you, you'll know what it means and you'll be very excited. When copying to destinations that require UAC elevation and queuing additional copies to the same place, you'll now only be prompted for elevation once. While files are copying, Opus will prevent the computer from going to sleep again after the old method was broken by changes in Windows. Copying enormous numbers of very small files should now be faster, as we fix some bottlenecks caused by updating the progress dialog too often. When copying files to a FAT file system, copies will now fail immediately for any files which are larger than 4 GB, since those files cannot fit on FAT and FAT32 drives. When copying to a removable drive which becomes temporarily disconnected, the retry button will now restart the current file from scratch, instead of only trying to retry the last write operation, which would always fail. You should still never pull a device out while it's being written to, but if you do, it won't be as bad as it was. The Copy Files button normally copies from the source side to the destination side. You can also use drag and drop or copy and paste as in Explorer. However, if you often need to copy files to a particular folder, you can make a button to do that without that folder having to be open in another window. And it's now also possible to make a button which prompts you for a destination folder, but has a specified path as its default. So when I click this button to copy the selected files, a dialog will open with Ctemp preselected, and if that's what I want, I can just click OK. but if I want something else, I can choose another folder. This dialog now also includes a drop-down list for selecting any open folder tab as your destination. The progress dialog speed graph can now be turned off. When renaming in the folder tree, you can now use hotkeys to change the case of letters, as was already possible in other places. And you can now move up and down with the cursor keys to rename adjacent folders with fewer keystrokes. In the Copy As dialog for making copies of files with modified names, the first push of the Home or End keys will now stop in the middle at the file extension. Hotkeys for selecting parts of the file name are also now supported there. For example, you can push Ctrl-E to select the file extension and then type over it without having to manually position the cursor there. The same hotkeys work in other places like the Replace dialog as well as the file displays themselves, but the Copy As dialog had been overlooked until now. Note that the Replace dialog now shows you the full path of each file. When renaming in the file display, you can copy an adjacent file name from above or below into the Edit field. We've added a new alternative hotkey for copying the file name above, which is easier to use on some keyboards. When copying file names in this way, the current file extension is usually preserved, but if you hold down the Alt key, the extension will be replaced as well. That's all there is in part 3, but part 4 will bring more directory opus. You can't get enough of it.